Okay. The lab you are taking, or studying, doing, whatever this week is Kirchhoff's lab. And it ain't bragging if you can do it. I am the Kirchhoff's Law master. There is no one else better than me. Now, that said, the TAs have been warned, you all will be doing it my way. You will not be doing it the TAs way. The TAs have been, they'll have their own particular way. Don't listen to them. Do it my way. Because inevitably, you will get it wrong if you listen to somebody else. Trying to think of the one thing that this entire year I have given you with great joy the freedom to do whatever you want in terms of solving physics problems. And you have repeatedly said, just tell us what to do and we will do it. Now it is with great irony that this is the one time that I tell you, just do what I tell you to do and you will get it right. And 70% of you will basically go, well, I talked to my sister's best friend's former bookstore manager who read it off a bathroom wall that we could do it this way. And what happened? I got it wrong. Shocked. Just shocked. I am the best there is. I know it. Who said it? I said it. When did I say it? Right now. Do what I say, everything will be fine. Don't do what I say, you fall in the velociraptor pit and the velociraptors eat your face. How simple can it be? So, I'm just letting you know right now, inevitably, throughout the rest of the week, I will hear horror stories about how you got it wrong. And inevitably, it will fall down to one thing. I wanted to see if I could do it this way. And then what happened? I fell in the velociraptor pit. And then what happened? A velociraptor came up to me and ate my face. Shocked. Shocked. So we got that out of the way. Let's do this. You will be presented with this. A simple box with a couple of batteries. And a couple of resistors. And the placement of the batteries, they're going to be placing batteries all over the place. And the numbering doesn't really matter. And so you'll get something like this. And a lot of times the TAs will go, well, what's that? And what's that? And most importantly, what's this? This problem comes down to one thing, and actually you are looking at one of the test two problems. This problem, maybe with different resistors and all that fun stuff, different values, probably even fewer resistors, but you will get a problem like this. At its core, it is a two equation, two unknown. Now I know at the mentioning of those words, little flecks of souls of all the students around here have died off just a little bit, because you hear two equation, two unknown, you just go nuts. We've done it simply. We've done it a little bit more complex. Now we're going to do it a little even more complex. But at its base, it's a two equation, two unknown. That's all you got to do. So we're going to set this problem aside for a moment, and we're going to talk about references. Now, in the beginning, you had a frame of reference, the x-axis. If you went left, it was negative. If you went right, it was positive. And so if you had a velocity that was negative 2, your speed was 2 to the left. If your velocity was positive 2, your speed was 2 to the right. How simple is that? We're all familiar with that. We've all done 213. We've all done the one-dimensional motion. And if you see a velocity that's to the left, you know that its speed is positive and to the left, its velocity is negative, all that fun stuff. And then we moved on to the Atwood's machine. And what we did is we took this and we bent it. Just bent it by 90 degrees. And so what we came to the realization is that in this frame of reference, up and left, oh, that's horrible spelling. Up and left is negative. Down and right is positive. So if you had a velocity that was negative, these objects are flowing up and to the left. If you had a velocity, so velocity equals negative 2, your speed is equal to 2, up and left. If your velocity was equal to positive 2, your speed is still equal to 2, but it is down and right. And we've come to grasp with this. And so what we're going to do with this is we're going to take our reference frame and we're going to just bend it. And so with this, now what we've done is we've taken that loop and we've bent it not 90 degrees, but around itself into a circle. And what I'm going to do is instead of using X, since we're dealing with currents, one of the letters that they also use, and not many other people do it this way, but it makes it, I have been studying Kirchhoff's law since before you were born. And so every year I study, what did they get wrong and how can I make it better to communicate to it? So the first time I did it was a miserable failure. The next time I tried, it got a little bit better. Now I'm really refining it, making subtle changes so that it's as easy as possible for you guys to learn it. Instead of using X, I'm going to use J. And I can think of J as, like, you can think of it as a current velocity. So you can have J's that are positive, you can have J's that are negative. If a J is 2 amps, a positive 2 amps, your I, or current, is 2 amps clockwise. if your J is negative 2 amps, your I is 2 amps counterclockwise. So the name of the axis is J. You may notice a lot of, in other systems of measurement, they do use J as current. What we're going to do is we're going to treat it as the current velocity. And then I is what we call current speed, or what we just call as current. So current will always be positive, and it will be in a certain direction, either clockwise or counterclockwise. J will be could be positive or negative. So what we have here is we set up our little box, and we set up two loops. A J1 and J2. Those are our current velocity axes. Each box gets a loop. And you may notice that here, it's all J1. The only current flowing through here is related to the axis of J1. The current flowing through here is J2, and then through here you get J1 and J2 flowing through that wire. So for a simple Kirchhoff's law problem, all the wires only have one current with the exception of one, and that's the middle wire, which will be a combination of J1 and J2. Now these loops what you're going to do is you're going to follow the J loops and make two equations. What you're going to do is for each of these loops, you're going to start in the lower left hand corner. So for loop one, you're going to go around again in a clockwise rotation. Now the thing about Kirchhoff's law is there are dozens of different ways to do this. The reason why I'm doing it this way is because after many years of slowly just polishing it to a fine sheen, this is about as efficient as we can get. And then you've got loop two. Again, you start here and you go around like this. Now you may notice there are no grounds. These are unnecessary. I don't know how to spell unnecessary. It's unnecessary for me to know how to spell unnecessary. So there are no grounds. And the reason why there are no grounds is because with these loops, you're going to start and stop at the same place. So if I, this, let's just assume that this room with the these paths are the loop. And if I start here, and I go up there, I go up a particular height, I walk along the back of the room, I come down that side, and I come right here, what's my change in height? Nothing. And so what we're going to do is around these loops, the change in potential will be zero. Because if you start at the lower left corner of wire, and you go all the way around, and you stop at that lower left corner, what do you know is fact? That the change in potential is zero. So for each of these loops, for loop one, the delta V is zero, and for loop two, the delta V is zero. Excuse me. So we've constructed our loops. We've identified the fact that there's going to be no change in potential. And now let's add another layer of the rules. So what? When moving along the loop, you encounter three things: wire, resistor, and battery. So there are three possible objects in this circuit that you can encounter. The wire, you don't care. The change in V for this will be zero. For a battery, the delta V is not dependent on current. It depends only on the alignment of the battery or polarity. So if you have a battery and you moved across from the positive to the negative lead, and let's say this battery had a strength of V, your delta V is negative V. If you went from negative to positive across that same battery, your delta V is equal to positive V. So when you're running around on your loops and you encounter a battery, the important thing that you need to figure out is not the current. Don't care about the current. But just go from, if I'm going from negative to positive lead, it's positive. It's going from positive to negative, it's negative. Now for resistors, it is J dependent if your J is like that, and your J is like this. Really, this is with current, your J current, and this is against. Now remember in Ohm's law has I equals V over R. Or V is equal to IR. When you're jumping with the current, your delta V is equal to negative JR. If you're jumping against the current, your delta V is equal to positive JR. So if you're going with the current, your potential falls. If you're going against the current, the potential rises up. Much like when we were doing the study of those circuits for the test for last week, if you're going with the current, you're falling potential. You're like going down a waterfall. If you're going up a waterfall, you increase in potential. So the J is our water, and if you're going against the water, increase in potential, with the water, decrease in potential. So now we know all of our rules, and these are what you need to know. Those four, those are the big four. The wire, we don't care. So let's make our loops, or our loop equations. So we go all the way back to our problem. And what we're going to do is we're going to start here. And really what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put in J1 and J2. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to work with this left loop here. Now some of you may be looking, but aren't you going to pay attention to capital I1, I2, I3? My answer, no. Don't care. The goal, our first goal is find J1 and J2. Once you have J1 and J2, everything else just falls away. And you can get those. So for our first loop, let me just draw it out. We have J1 going like this, and then on the other side we do have to consider a little bit of J2. I have an R1, an R2, plus minus V is equal to 10. And I'm really not considering the numbers just yet. So for our first loop, I'm going to label these points A, B, C, and D. A to B, with J1 across R2. So the delta V from A to B for that part is minus J1 R2. From B to to see is with J1 across R1. So delta V is negative J1 R1. For C to D, now actually I forgot the resistor. That resistor is R3. When you're going from C to D, pay attention to the fact that there are actually two currents going through this resistor. When you're going from C to D, you're going with J1 but against J2. Because there are two currents flowing through. In the end, they'll cancel each other out or reinforce each other, and you'll add them together. But when you're making this equation, you have to consider both. So from C to D, your delta V is negative J1 R3 plus J2 R3. So you drop potential because of J1, you increase potential because of J2. And the last part, D to A, you're going from the negative to the positive end of the battery. D to A, you're going from negative to positive. So your delta V is equal to V1, positive V1. Make sure I got that labeled. So now, our total delta V for loop 1 is equal to 0, which is equal to minus J1 R2 minus J1 R1 minus J1 R3 plus J2 R3 plus V1. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to simplify it just a little bit. 0 equals J2 R3 minus J1 R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus V1. Now we have one of the equations that we're going to use, and the two unknowns are J1 and J2. And I really painstakingly went through the first construction of the loop just because we just got to dig through every little bit. Now we're going to speed it up just a little bit. And in our loop 2, so this is for loop 1, this is for loop 2. Now loop 2 starts down here, moves up, over, down, and back. Loop 2, we're going first step A, B, C, and D. A to B, we're going with J2 across R3. So minus J2, R3. We're going with or against the J1 current, J1R3, and that's the first part. We're going from there to there against J2, but with J2, but against J1. Second part, we're going from the positive to the negative end of the battery. So that's minus V2. This part, we're going with J2 across R5. So minus J2, R5, and then from there to there, minus J2, R4. And the change in potential is zero. So the hardest part about this problem is setting up your basic equations for loop one and for loop two. And I'm going to clean this up a bit. And so now I have my loop two equation. Normally, I don't believe in plugging in numbers until the very end. But for this particular case, it simplifies things immensely. So I'm going to plug in my resistors and my voltages, because after I plug them in and add up the resistances, you will see a much simpler equation coming out. So 0 equals 30 J1 minus R3, R4, and R5, 50, 95 J2. R3 is 30, R4 is 20, R5 is 45, so that's 95. Minus V2, minus 15. Now with this equation, the other reason why I like to do this is I like to factor out common numbers. And this is definitely divisible by 5. So this is 6J1 minus 95 divided by 5, 19 J2 minus 3. That's a much easier equation to handle rather than looking at all of these letters. And so this is the one time where plugging the stuff in does help. Looking at loop 1, 30 J2 minus R1, R2, R3 minus 45 J1. R1 is 5, R2 is 10, R3 is 30. So that's 45. V1 is 10, so positive 10. It is also divisible by 5, so this becomes 0, 6 J2 minus 9 J1 plus 2. And so these are your two equations. At the beginning of like 213, I said, all right, this is just a simple two equation, two unknown, and we did it in the basic math of 3a plus 2b equals 5 and a minus b equals 6, and we showed you how easy it is. This is all it is. We've broken it down. The hardest part is setting it up. And now, we just solve for it. Look for the easiest one to solve. Let's just do J1. So 6J1 is equal to 3 plus 19 J2. Or J1 is equal to 3 plus 19 J2 over 6. So the first thing you do is you take one of the equations, you find the one that you think is the easiest to solve, and then you solve for it. You take it and you plug it into the other one. So 0 equals 6j2 minus 9, 3 plus 19j2 over 6 plus 2. So all we did was substitute that into there. And so now we just take a look at what we can do to solve for J2. We can do all sorts of things. I'm going to multiply by 6. 6 times that, 36J2 minus 6 times this is minus 9, 3 plus 19J2 plus 12. So all the that 6 went away when multiplied by 6, and those 6's attacked all the rest of the stuff. So now we got that. Minus 27, minus 19 times 9, 171. And as you can see, with every step, things begin to look easier and easier. I'm going to go 171J2 minus 36J2. Equals minus 27 plus 12. 135J2, and this is minus 15. So J2, and I would keep this for the moment in fractions, unless it gets really good. Let's see. J2 is minus 1/9 amp. So now that we have J2, J1 is 3 plus 19 minus 1/9 over 6. So 19 times negative answer plus 3 divided by 6. And I get 4/27 of an amp. 1/9 or 4/27 is 0.1481 amp, and 1/9 is 0.1111 amp. So J1 is positive and J2 is negative. So if J1 is positive, then I1 is clockwise with a magnitude of 0.1481 amps. And J2 is negative, which means it is a counterclockwise I2. And I2 has a magnitude of 0.1111 amp. So by taking those J2s, we can determine the actual currents flowing through the system. Now what I'm going to do, once you have J1 and J2, the rest, everything else just falls into place and is beautiful. So we have our circuit. We've determined our J's, and we know that I1 looks like this, and we have I2, which looks like that. And what you can see, looking back at the beginning, the capital I's were all just randomly placed, and the TAs like to do this. And I always love to have a class right next to the bus stop. Whoever thought of that was a genius. What you notice, hold on. If I3 was pointing up, I'll get to that in just a second. Because the important part now, let's say we lived in a world where I3 was pointed up, and we still had the same values, I1 and I2. In this case, I3 is the negative of I1 plus I2. So in that universe, it would be 0.2592 amp. Now let's look at, what I'm going to do is, well, we've already done. So look at capital I1 and capital I2. Capital I1 is opposite of I1, and capital I2 is opposite of I2. So capital I1 is just minus I1, or minus 0.1111 amp. Capital I2 is minus I2, which is minus 0.1481 amp.
Those backwards.
Oh, do I have them back?
I1 is 0.1481.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, okay, now I see it. All right. And so there you go. So you look at what direction the TA wants, and you go, well, I know that I1 is this value. His I1 is opposite of my I1, so I just drop a negative sign on it. His I2 was in the opposite direction, so I drop in a negative sign. But his I3 was in the same direction as my I1 and I2, so I just add them together and give the answer that he wants. In this problem, Your J1 can either be positive or negative. Your J2 can be positive or negative. Positive values mean that it is in a clockwise motion. So J1 positive means that they look like this. J2 is positive, so it also means it is a clockwise motion, and notice that I'm drawing it a little bit different, but in the end it's still clockwise. Negative values produce counterclockwise, so J1 is negative, so it produces a negative counterclockwise. And same with J2. So if it has a negative, the current will produce a counterclockwise. If it's a positive, it'll produce a clockwise. Now what you can see here, the bottom line for the test, because in the test I'm not really big on capital I1 and capital I2 and all that fun stuff. The bottom line question is, what's the current flowing through the middle resistor, and is it going from bottom to top or top to bottom? In the test, that's all I want. If you do well on test 2 with this, you won't see it for the final. If you do badly, you'll see it again. There are two possibilities which you are hoping for. The one where one's positive and the other one is negative. Because in this case, this one is counterclockwise, that one is clockwise, the currents both go from bottom to top. And all you have to do is go I1 plus I2 bottom to top, because the currents flow in the same direction from the bottom of the circuit to the top. Here, so for this one, it is minus positive. Here it's positive, negative. In this case, the currents are producing current going from top to bottom. In this case, it's I1 plus I2 top to bottom. You just add the I's together, which are the absolute values of the J's, and then you go. With these two, it's a little bit more complex, but not by much. To determine the I value that you need, you take the I of the bigger and subtract from it the I of the smaller. And then it goes in the direction of the bigger. So let's do a few quick examples. Let's do the easy ones first. Let's say we had J1 is 2 amps, J2 is negative 1 amp. So for negative 1 amp, it's counterclockwise. For positive, it's clockwise. So I1 is 2, I2 is 1. They're both going from top to bottom through that middle resistor. So I middle is 2 plus 1 or 3 amps top to bottom. Let's say J1 was negative 2 amps, or J1 was negative 2 amps, and J2 was positive 1 amp. Then you draw it like this. I1 is equal to 2, I2 is equal to 1, I in the middle is 2 plus 1, which is equal to 3 amps. And because both of the currents are going from bottom to top, you say bottom to top. Now those were the easy ones. Let's do the two hard ones. Let's say we had a J1 is equal to 3 amps and a J2 which is equal to 2 amps, which means both of them are going clockwise. Now I1 is 3, I2 is 2. With this particular case, which one is the stronger current? I1, which means the stronger current is going from top to bottom or from bottom to top? Top to bottom. So this is 3 minus 2, or 1 amp, top to bottom. If it was J1 is equal to 2 amps and J2 is equal to 3 amps, I1 would be 2, I2 would be 3. The stronger current would now be the one on the right, which means the current goes from bottom to top. 3 minus 2, which is 1 amp, bottom to top. And then the last possibility, J1 is negative 3, J2 is negative 2, this is your stronger current than this one. So I1 is equal to 3, I2 is equal to 2, so I middle is 3 minus 2, which is 1 amp, and that's the stronger one, so it goes from bottom to top. In the last case, J1 is negative 2 amps, J2 is negative 3 amps, the stronger of the currents is the one on the right. I1 is 2, I2 is 3, so I in the middle is 3 minus 2, which is 1 amp, and it goes from top to bottom. And so those are the possibilities. You can really just look at this sheet right here, and this would give you kind of the cheat sheet for what's going on. In this problem, and we're going to break in the next like 3 or 4 minutes, so we'll have a lot of time. The part that's important is set up the two loop equations. Set up the loop equations, knowing what to do with the battery and the resistor, and what direction are you moving, In which direction are you against or with? Are you flowing with J1 or J2? Two, solve J1 and J2 using the two equation, two unknown method. And then last, evaluate I1 and I2, and most importantly, I middle, the current running through the middle resistor, using J1 and J2. And that's really it. Granted, it took us an hour to cover just this Kirchhoff's law, this one particular problem. Once you're familiar with the technique, a Kirchhoff law problem should go down in about 10 minutes. You should just be able to crank it out. I can almost look at a circuit and just write out the equation that I need to do, the two equation two unknown. It requires practice. It looks hard, but like everything else we've been studying this year, with practice comes mastery. And lastly, don't listen to anybody else. Don't read the instructions on how to do a Kirchhoff's law equations on the bathroom wall. They will definitely get it wrong. Listen to only me, please. Thank you. See you on Thursday. Thank you.